The Illuminati Formula to Create an Undetectable Total Mind Control Slave by Fritz Springmeier and Cisco Wheeler. Podcast 9. Chapter 5a, The Skill of Lying, The Art of Deceit. Continues. Alice in Wonderland. Alice through the looking glass.
I can't believe that, said Alice.
Can't you? The Queen said in a pitying tone.
Try again, draw a long breath, and shut your eyes.
Alice laughed.
There's no use trying, she said.
One can't believe impossible things.
I dare say you haven't had much practice, said the Queen.
When I was your age, I always did it for half an hour a day.
Why, sometimes I believed as many as 6 impossible things before breakfast.
The chapter which dreamed it in Alice Through the Looking Glass has sexual programming, the Red Queen is purring.
The story where walruses make believe it is oysters is used for programming.
Other sexual programming occurs in the chapter It's My Own Invention where the knight in crimson, and white, armor are prisoners which duel for her.
Tweedledee and Tweedledum is used for sand M programming, which has a hand signal involving rotating the thumbs of a clasp hand.
Alters go through the looking glass, and fall down an oak tree by falling into a deeper and deeper trance.
Monarch programming is a reflection of how Satan's mind works.
Lewis Carroll's book with its inversion themes fits in with this type of thinking.
Lewis Carroll loved the humor of logical contradictions.
In the book, Alice wonders if cats eat bats or bats eat cats, and she is told that to say what she means is not the same as meaning what she says.
When she eats the left side of the mushroom, she grows large, the right side has the reverse effect.
These changes in size are in themselves reversals.
A large girl and small puppy end up to be a large puppy and a small girl.
In Silvia and Bruno, we are presented with an anti-gravity wool that can be placed into a parcel to make it weigh less than nothing, a watch that reverses time, a black light, and a projective plane with outside inside and inside outside.
The slave learns that evil is simply live backwards.
In the looking glass world, the Red Queen knows of a hill so large that compared to it the hill in question is a valley.
Also she knows of dry biscuits which quench thirst, a messenger who whispers by shouting, and Alice who runs as fast as she can to stay in one place.
Sometimes it seems we really do have to run fast to stay in place.
The King of Hearts thinks it's not unusual to write letters to nobody, and the White King compliments Alice on having keen enough eyesight to see nobody at a great distance down the road.
Can you see why this book was so good to program us?
In the book Through the Looking Glass, all asymmetrical objects, that means all objects which can't be superimposed on their mirrored image, go the other way.
There are left-right reversals.
Tweedledee and Tweedledum are mirror image twins.
The White Knight sings about squeezing his right foot into a left shoe, and there are several mentions of corkscrews.
A helix, a corkscrew, is an asymmetric structure with distinct left and right forms.
The book's type of thinking was extended beyond asymmetrical objects to asymmetrical relations of all types.
For example, Alice walks backward, in the railway carriage the guard tells her she is traveling the wrong way.
The king has 2 messengers, one to come and one to go.
The White Queen explains the advantages of living backward in time, the looking glass cake is handed around first, then sliced.
Odd and even numbers, which are equivalent to left and right or on and off, are worked into the story at several points.
For instance, the White Queen requests jam every other day.
Going through the looking glass takes us to a world where the ordinary world is turned upside down and backward.
Things go every which way except the way they are supposed to go.
Antimatter is a mirror image.
Antimatter milk will explode Alice, but an antimatter Alice on the other side of the looking glass can drink the antimatter milk.
In Chapter 11 Alice captures the Red Queen.
It results in a legitimate checkmate of the Red King, who has slept through the entire life-size chess game without moving.
The checkmate ends the dream, but leaves open in the story the question of whether the dream was Alice's or the Red King's.
The programming has so often been only a dream to us.
The outside world was so often just an unreal dream to us.
What was real and what was not real?
The real world,
for other people, was full of contradictions, and the unreal world, our internal world, was consistent. Everything was upside down, forwards, and backwards. In the Looking Glass book, one shuttles back and forth mysteriously between real and dream worlds. So, either I've been dreaming about life or I only dream that life is but a dream. As a slave breaks away from the programming, life becomes a bewildering confusion as the slave is pulled between two worlds. The internal world has everything the altar needs, the external world is a harsh cold reality that doesn't have much to offer. People in the external world can help make it real for a slave. The handlers will never do this. Altars will need a reason to want to come out of the internal reality which they are programmed to believe in. For so long much of life was seen as a dream. It will be hard to get a grasp on what was real and what was the lie. Many of the lies are more real than the truth. Life was sometimes like the parallel dreams of the Red King and Alice, like two mirrors facing each other. The Tall Book of Make-Believe. This book was published by Harper & Row in 1950 and was indeed tall, the pages being 4 inches by 9.5 inches. On page 14, the programmer would read the first paragraph of the poem and then say, "Sleep, sleep, sleep. Have you ever heard of the sugar plum tree? 'Tis a marvel of great renown. It blooms on the shore of the lollipop sea in the garden of Shut-Eye Town. The fruit that it bears is so wondrously sweet, as those who have tasted it say, that good little children have only to eat of that fruit to be happy next day. Sleep, sleep, sleep." On pages 16 to 17, there is a story about how a child is dragged under the kitchen door and becomes flat. There is a picture of a child being pulled under a door and coming out flat on page 17. This was used as part of the script to make the ribbons for the slaves. The ribbons in a system can go under doors and through the entire system. On page 23, Rosa the flat person, pancake person, is shown again. This is ribbon. The top of the page has a large cricket-like creature that was said to the child to be the programmer, Dr. Mangel. All of the stories in the Tall Book of Make-Believe were used one way or the other in programming. We will just touch on some notable points. On page 38 is a poem about a Mr. Nobody. The programmers like to have alters identify themselves as nobody. On page 39 is a poem and story about someone who comes tapping, but it is only the cricket whistling. This was used to help program in that the three taps were the cricket, the cover image for the programmer. On page 50, is the story of a girl who when she lays down becomes a different person, Mrs. Brown. On page 67 is a poem Foreign Lands, where the child sees the sky's blue looking glass and then ends up to where the roads on either hand lead onward into fairyland. And all the playthings come alive. In other words, what is in effect being communicated is, take the hypnotic image of flying into the sky in Papa Silver plane, as the plane goes up the trance goes higher deeper, and then go into a fantasy land where all your wishes can come true so that you can escape the hell us programmers are giving you. On page 79 is the story of a ghost named Georgie who would run home and warn people at home when things were broken. This was part of the fix me programming so that ghost-like alters, known as reporting alters, call home to Papa if the programming is touched. On page 84 is the story how they bring back the village of cream puffs when the wind blows it away. This story has several programming words in it. These words and their meanings are as follows. In programming, the village of liver and onions is a code word for the coven. Prairie means ceremony site, and in another story picnic means ritual. It's doubtful that most alters would remember these meanings, but they help the abusers confuse the child. Imagine the victim trying to describe a ritual and telling someone that a village of liver and onions had a picnic. Alien programming scripts. There are numerous scripts for the alien programming. Recent novels and Hollywood movies provide a non-ending pool of programming resources for the programmers. Visual reality headgear and other high-tech methods can easily be incorporated into an alien abduction theme. The following are samples of some of the people who the author Fritz has spent time with, who on one level knew they needed help, but didn't know just what they felt uneasy about. Person 1. Had been abducted by aliens since she was a small child. Different types of aliens took her. Her mother worked for the CIA at Area 51. Her mother was abusive to her. One of her best friends is a monarch slave. When the aliens come, a bright light appears and then they abduct her. The aliens she works with the most look exactly like people, and in their handwriting show severe abuse. These benevolent aliens have taken her fetuses several times. She has time traveled to their planet. She is dissociative. The government authorities are constantly monitoring and tracking her, and have made an effort to besmudge her record, so that it appears like she is Looney Tunes. This is the type of cases that this book's co-author has spent time working with. Doesn't this sound more like human mind control than real aliens? Person 2. This person hears aliens within his head, which when described sounds like a case of MPD, did. The aliens would take him and force him to have homosexual activities even though he didn't want to participate. But that was okay to him, because they were a superior race, and if these benevolent aliens, which are so far advanced beyond us, want to have sex with him, that is their prerogative. This person has a lot of depression. This person wonders why the authorities seem to keep track of him. Person 3. This person worked at Area 51. Has a photographic memory throughout his entire MPD system. He realizes that he is MPD. His best friend claims to be an alien, a god of sorts, and is known by both this person and Fritz to be part of naval intelligence. This best friend acts more like a handler than an alien, and this Area 51 worker gives his best friend total allegiance. This man has all kinds of alien-type stories, which sound in many cases like programming. This person admits that his family is Illuminati, and the front altars say he has watched Illuminati rituals as an adult, but hasn't participated. He shows signs of severe abuse. He is afraid to talk about trauma-based mind control, but loves to talk about aliens. In fact, all three of the persons discussed on this page shied away from talking about monarch mind control, as if it were something not important, but they all love to talk about aliens. And the list of interesting people like this could go on. When mind-controlled slaves who have alien programming are being abducted by the intelligence agencies for their use and for programming, here are some of the details of how and what occurs. A bright light is shined into their house. They have been hypnotically conditioned to view this light as a flying saucer, whether it is a helicopter or something else. As the NWO does have flying saucers, sometimes the real thing is used. Men in black, just like in SRA cases, are often associated with the abductions. And the slaves frequently speak about shadows in the mind. The slaves are taken to rooms where examining tables with white sheets and X-ray machines, headgear and medical equipment is in place. The alien equipment has gotten more high-tech over the last 40 years. The aliens wear suits that are full of occult symbology. The people are restrained with clamps and electrical shock and energy is used on them. They are told that they are receiving information. They are given tracking implants and other implants. All of the three above persons receive information from the aliens regularly. Almost all of the elements of monarch trauma-based mind control appear in these abduction accounts, especially in the psychological features of the victim. The victims of alien abduction programming feel suicidal after they talk too much. They have headaches, sleep difficulties, nightmares, obsessive thoughts, fear of hypnosis, trapped feelings, and paranoia. During their abductions, the aliens use drugs, thought transfers, and painful medical procedures. The aliens use language that parallels the messages given to SRA victims, just change the language from Satan is in charge to the aliens are in charge. Cattle mutilations where the blood has been drained are associated with abductions. There are documented accounts where cattle mutilations have been connected to satanic cults using helicopters. The victims of aliens are forced to be impregnated and then the fetus is repeatedly taken. The aliens are repeatedly telling these victims that a Holocaust is soon to come. Another strange phenomena that others and this author have noticed is that these victims of alien abduction seem to know each other, much in the same way that victims of Illuminati mind control seem to know each other. And the aliens seem to know everything about the victims. The victims have amnesia of their abductions. The memories of their abductions are hidden in altered states of consciousness, that hypnosis sometimes can pull up. Most victims are afraid of hypnosis or can't be hypnotized, they have been hypnotized not to allow anyone else to hypnotize them. To give credit where due, Bo Ward's Operation Mind Control Researcher's Edition, 1994, has an excellent appendix with charts which compare SRA mind control victims and alien abduction victims. The charts reveal how similar the two groups are. In preparing these paragraphs, we have used his charts as a basis for how we wrote these last two paragraphs up. However, the co-author's experiences in working with abduction victims match the findings of Bo Ward. Do aliens from another planet exist? They may or may not. It is not a real issue, we have to face what is already on this planet. Fritz has several tapes of aliens of different types talking, which were obtained from abduction survivors, and their voices sound demonic and they are saying that they have been alive on this planet for many years. One said something like he has been here on Earth 500,000 years. If an alien has lived on this planet for 500,000 years, when does he get residence status? My. If that is true, he is no alien we are. But one thing is certain, this planet contains some very slimy evil creatures who are either real non-humans or very deceptive dark humans. The Bible calls them demons and reprobate men. The four most popular origins of supposed aliens on Earth are all star groups relatively close to our solar system. They are, the Pisciades, known as the Seven or Nine Sisters, because there are nine stars of which seven are visible, Sirius, the Dog constellation, the Orion constellation, and the twin stars of Zeta Reticuli, which twin stars were amazingly charted by Chinese astrologers in 3000 BC. Fritz, the co-author of this book, kept an open mind on the issue: could there be any benevolent aliens? Some abductees believed that their aliens were benevolent, but when they are debriefed they admit that mind control and sexual molestation is carried out by the aliens. Fritz has concluded with other investigators on this question: there are no benevolent aliens, in fact the only aliens that may be around are what have been known as demons. People who have participated in high-level Illuminati ceremonies report the presence of creatures that look like the various aliens. This whole subject is dealt with in another book by Fritz Springmeier. Some points might be briefly brought out. Fritz has amassed a great deal of evidence that the elite have human-built flying saucers. Notice how the controlled media always link aliens with flying saucers and UFOs? This is an entire book in itself, however, the bottom line is that at least most, if not all, of the alien abductions are simply part of the NWO's mind control. It is obvious that for various reasons, including the goals set down in the secret Iron Mountain government report, the government, including cooperating agencies like NASA, decided to use an alien abduction theme rather than a satanic ritual abuse theme to their mind control programming. The major differences in the programming methodology is that the blood rituals of the SRA are no longer used. The reason why blood rituals are no longer needed is that the high-tech harmonic machines, which implant thought, see Chapter 6, and other high-tech methods eliminate the need for the blood traumas. The victims of alien abductions are taken at random, where the Illuminati victims are abducted more frequently around ritual dates. The person who believes in UFOs and aliens is going to receive the same type of treatment as those who believe in satanic ritual abuse. The legal system and society at large are conditioned to treat them as nuts. This protects their abusers. An Illuminati hierarchy member described their magic goal of pursuing a spiritual path through the finer frequencies of outer time. The alien programming is one way to experience this. Island of the Blue Dolphins. This is a child's book by Scott Odell. The people of an island have both an everyday name and a magical name. When the chief gives his magical name to a Russian captain named Erlov, he and his warriors end up being killed in battle. The altars of monarch slaves have names they can give outsiders and then their access code names which must be kept secret. Part of the story is to stay in line with what one's ancestors have done. Other items in the book, such as the four winds from the four directions, fit in with programming too. The book is just one of many that the programmers want the children to hear so that they naturally adopt the correct programming scripts. The Lord of the Rings. Some Illuminati survivors are always looking for a ring. Rings play a significant part in the lives and programming of slaves. One section that is coding and programming found in J.R.R. Tolkien's Lord of the Rings is one ring to rule them all, one ring to find them, one ring to bring them all and in the darkness bind them. The most important programming script, the Lesser Key. One of the most important scripts for the Illuminati mind control programmers is the Lesser Key of Solomon Goetia, the Book of Evil Spirits. The Illuminati doctors Green, Black, White and Blue, that is Manchel, Wheeler, Cameron, and Mueller, were fully knowledgeable about the Lesser Key of Solomon Goetia. In fact, all those who go beyond the initial levels in the Illuminati are required to study the entire book. It is an important ritual book. It is very out of fashion to believe in demons. It is in fashion to believe in aliens, in ghosts, in the internal psychological wizard that guides you, and other things which to those high in demonology secretly know are simply covers for what used to be called demons. Both the high-level Illuminati and the alert Christians are saying many of the same things concerning demons. Is magical phenomena real? Do the programmers really believe in it? In the Lesser Key of Solomon Goetia it answers, I am not concerned to deny the objective reality of all magical phenomena, if they are illusions, they are at least as real as many unquestioned facts of daily life, and, they are at least evidence of some cause, page 10. The author of the Lesser Key of Solomon Goetia then points out that all our sense impressions of the universe are dependent upon changes in the brain. Reality is a perception of the mind. So the author states, we must include illusions, which are after all sense impressions as much as realities are, in the class of phenomena dependent on brain changes. Magical phenomena, however, come under a special subclass, since they are willed, and their cause is the series of real phenomena called the operations of ceremonial magic. In other words, when the Illuminati practice ceremonial magic, their magic to them is as real as life, but they do not feel a need to defend its reality. People in the occult encourage children to fantasize. Fantasy is looked at with favor. Whether the power and healing and mind control of demonology stems from illusion or Jung's autonomous power of the human psyche to attract and manifest archetypes through the human soul or some other source is not an issue for Satanists. They are seeing results, power, healings and the destruction of their enemies by demonology. Within the Illuminati, illusion, myth, and perception are all esteemed. Are they alone? Are they alone? No, they are not alone. The myth that the United States is a democracy is probably a far stronger reality in the minds of Americans than the actual reality that it is a tightly controlled secret oligarchy with a Republican front. But in this case, which is the greater real reality? The American believes his myth enough that he dies for it? He fights the war to end all wars and then the war to save the world for democracy, to quote some popular World War slogans. In the American mind, he achieves victory even though he has fought and died for a myth. And even when the mythical goals he fought for aren't even achieved, he believes he has achieved a victory. The First World War never brought everlasting peace and the war to save the world for democracy ended after victory with more of the world under stronger totalitarian rule than before the war began. The bottom line is that myths and illusions make up a large part of the reality of most people's lives. Movie actors have repeatedly found out that they incur their fans' wrath if they try to reveal their real selves to the public. The point also is that the person practicing ceremonial magic will not be impressed by the average person, even if he be a minister, who has structured his life on myths and illusions, who will tell him that his ceremonial magic is not real. The magician will naturally ask, who is living in a world of reality? Ceremonial magic is a very strong reality to the Illuminati's mind-controlled slaves, because the programmers make great efforts to develop the five impressions listed on page 11 of the Lesser Key, which are 1, Sight. The circle, square, triangle, vessels, lamps, robes, implements, etc. 2, Sound. The invocations. 3, Smell. The perfumes. 4, Taste. The sacraments. 5, Touch. As under, 1. These are reflected upon by the person, and these 5 produce unusual brain changes. Later 2 more senses are also highly developed. Programmed multiple slaves have visual and auditory acuity far beyond the normal person. The Lesser Keys of Solomon Goetia goes on to say, the spirits of the Goetia are portions of the human brain. Their seals therefore represent methods of stimulating or regulating those particular spots, through the eye, dot. The names of God are vibrations calculated to establish a. general control of the brain. B. control over the brain in detail. Rank or type of the spirit. C. control of one special portion. Name of spirit. The perfumes aid this through smell. Usually the perfume will only tend to control a large area, but there is an attribution of perfumes to letters of the alphabet enabling one, by a Kabbalistic formula, to spell out the spirit's name, P12. Did the reader grasp that? The most important script for the programmers is to use ceremonial magic which uses the names of God to establish general, and specific control, via a hierarchical arrangement of demons, over a person's mind. More will be covered about this in Chapter 10. But while we are on the subject, let's go just a little bit farther. If, then, I say, with Solomon, the spirit Semiuris teaches logic, what I mean is, those portions of my brain which subserve the logical faculty may be stimulated and developed by following out the processes called the invocation of Semiuris. And this is exactly what the programmers do. They invoke via many rituals all types of specific demons, or demonic energy, to enhance the particular mental functions they want. For instance, Typhon and Koronzin, also Horonzin, are demons who are essential in building the structure of a programmed multiple. They must be invoked before the early start of dividing the mind. Michael Bertios heads up the Horonzin Club, an unofficial part of Kenneth Grant's Odo. The demon Horonzin, or Koronzin, looks like a gray alien, and was conjured up by Sir John Dee, who was Queen Elizabeth I's genius advisor and court sorcerer. Transiagothian magic is carried out in order to reach Transiagothian space, also known as Transplutonian space and universe B. The existence of these dimensions is kept very secret. The ancient cult of the star Sirius, from which supposedly we are now getting aliens, had rituals to get one into the celebrated universe B. Sirius B, the binary twin star that exists with the actual Sirius A star, represented the god Ra-Horkut. Sirius A represented the Egyptian devil. Let's reflect on all this demonic illusion. As stated, an American will die for the myth that America is saving the world for democracy. This made sense to psychologists at the time. However, if a slave dies for what he sees as the reality of voodoo magic, the psychologist dismisses it as unimportant, a mere coincidence. Since voodoo magic doesn't exist in the psychologist's mind, the psychologist believes that magic carries no threat to its intended victim. Likewise, because the psychologist doesn't believe in demons, demons supposedly pose no threat to the mind-controlled slave. The psychologist is really projecting his perception of reality upon someone else, and it doesn't work. The Illuminati programmers are counting on the therapists ignoring demonology. In Bowart's in most respects excellent book Operation Mind Control, Researcher Edition, Fort Bragg CA, Flatland, 1994, page 249, asks the reader to self-hypnotize himself by several times looking into your mind's eye. To Bowart, he sees the trance state as merely looking into your mind's eye. He does not attribute any demonic activity to be involved with such things. No wonder, Bowart writes very disparagingly and critically about Christians who are trying to do demonic deliverances to slaves. But then, as far as I know, Bowart hasn't freed anyone of their mind control either, he is just a reporter. Both ministers and psychologists have contempt for each other's excesses. We must bear in mind that the victims of this total mind control have their bodies, minds, and spirits enslaved. The body, mind, and spirit need to be simultaneously liberated. A great deal of the success of the programmers is that ministers have rejected the study of the mind, psychology, and therapists have rejected spiritual things. The victim is left without a way to heal both spirit and mind. Partial freedom is still slavery. And not only that, but both therapists and ministers seem to feel the actual physical threats to the slave's body to be outside of their jurisdiction, and by default it is left up to the victim to provide. Which again, without the body safe and healed, the mind and spirit are not fully free. There are therapists and others who pontificate about how evil Christian ministers are for trying to deliver mind-controlled slaves from their demonic possession. This is not the problem. The problem is that the Illuminati have skillfully separated the various therapeutic elements both functionally and legally. The answer to the enslavement of body, soul, mind, and spirit is a team of people who will address all the issues together. Both the psychologists and ministers see the excesses of each other, but a little humility would go a long way, for both sides to recognize each other's value. God works through all people, even those who resist Him. That is why He can rightly be called Almighty God. The use of lies externally and internally, the use of covers and fronts, and the art of hiding things in a system. External deceptions. There seems to be no end to the lies that are involved with the monarch programming. The old adage that nothing is as it appears, is generally the rule. However, once one catches on to the common tactics of deceptions, the tactics themselves become red flags which can alert a thinking person to what is hidden. This is similar to those Russians who could read between the lines when reading communist propaganda and figure out the truth. The deception begins with covering up the identity of the slave. Within the Illuminati, the art of hiding genealogies is a fine art. Children are swapped and placed with foster parents. Mothers all of a sudden have babies, when no one has noticed them being pregnant. Investigators like Fritz Springmeier, who have been investigating courthouse records and other primary documents, have seen courthouse records altered overnight, to cover up genealogical and financial information. Covers for individual slaves. The individual slave is usually given a good cover. A good cover will be one that cannot be seen through, and still allows the person the freedom to get their job done. When building a cover, the following questions will be asked: how much will this cover allow this person to spend? What kind of people can this person associate with? Where can this person go? And what kind of hobby can he or she have? By now, the Illuminati have their secret slaves in so many places that they have their bases covered in all fields. True life examples include a monarch programmer who appears to be simply a middle-class housewife. A monarch computer programmer who appears to be a deaf and dumb mute when in the presence of the public, but the deeper brilliant alters work secretly at programming computers during the day. An international spy, who is a programmed multiple, who has a totally different set of ID and wigs, so that when they switch to certain alters used for the intelligence agencies, they not only act different, they look different, and have different valid ID. An apparently dumb blonde may be a very intelligent, highly trained monarch slave. Within the intelligence world, monarch slaves will function as agent provocateurs, which are people who join groups with the purpose of leading the group to do things that will cause it harm. The neo-Nazis are full of agent provocateurs, as are some of the patriot groups. Some monarch slaves are what is called clean agents, that is, they have never been used in intelligence work, so they have no record of use. Monarchs are great for being used by this or that group on a limited basis without anyone suspecting any connection. The intelligence term for the elaborate cover histories they give one of their monarch slaves to operate as an agent is called a legend. Supporting documents will be placed into the appropriate government files to support the legend. The intelligence agencies may have several intact legends for different personalities of a slave. The intelligence term is notional. It roughly means a fictional entity for the sake of an intelligence operation. Notional organizations are created to steal strength away from sincere organizations. If a church, or non-CIAKKK group, etc., gets too sincere and powerful, a well-financed notional rival will start up, and then later fold under scandal. The net effect is to destroy the entire cause. At least half of the therapists helping monarch slaves in the author's area are programmed multiples themselves. The therapeutic community is heavily infiltrated. The helplines for women in crisis are all dirty. Some of the Christian groups that claim to help SRA victims are really fronts. One recovering monarch slave tells about how her father was the mayor of an important city in Pennsylvania. He was part of the Illuminati and he introduced drugs into his area, and had a monopoly on illegal drugs in the area. As mayor, he established the first drug hotline, so that people could inform authorities about drug trafficking. He staffed the drug hotline with his own people and this allowed him to get tips to eliminate his competition. The intelligence agencies which are using mind control are hiding their drug trafficking and criminal activities. One of the ways they do this is the so-called war on drugs. The situation is so bad and widespread that even the controlled media has had news where they reported CIA agents smuggling drugs seized in South America into the US using government channels. When a slave is being programmed, the abusers will use schools, churches, Big Brothers, Boy Scouts and other activities to carry out the abuse and programming. Children pulled from classes will be given backup amnesia so that they forget that they forgot. In other words, they are totally unaware that they have lost time when they were pulled out of the classroom. The teacher gives them a test score, and they are told they took a test during the missing time. How can the front alters deny it, when they have been hypnotized to believe it and they can see the test scores? Altar boys and boys at Catholic orphanages have a record of being used by dirty priests. Recently, numerous priests have been discovered molesting children, and hundreds of lawsuits are underway, but it is still not coming out that this abuse is connected to trauma-based mind control. In the past, if the parents who were part of the Illuminati elite, but were not religious wanted their boy programmed, they could send him off to a military school run under the cooperation of the Catholic Church and units such as the 6th U.S. Army, which became one of the primary infiltrated units. The 6th Army uses the magical hexagram as its logo. This would provide the programmed child with a religious front. He could say, "I went to Catholic school." The programming could be disguised as discipline, etc. The establishment media have worked propaganda wonders for the abusers of the monarch mind control. Britain is extremely repressive in their information control. If any news medium tries to leak the most simplest of information, a secret document called a notice will be sent at any time of day to them from a denotice committee, and the media will have to stop whatever reference is deemed a secret. In the US it in effect works as tight, it just is not officially as tight. The abusers know that they also have an incredulous factor that can assist them. Who would believe that a sweet child drinks blood and is cannibalistic? The more that they can do that is far-fetched, the less credibility the child has if they do talk. Some children do try to talk. One monarch slave talked at age 5, and her entire family came down hard on her and blamed the child's talking for the death of one of the abusers. What kind of proof can a child bring that adults will accept? In the McMartin preschool case, about 800 children were witnesses whose stories corroborated the SRA and programming that was done, but the media, and the judicial system were able to cover up the abuse and make it look on television that the abusers were the victims. It wasn't until after the case was over and the property sold, that the tangible proof, the secret tunnels with paraphernalia, were found, and then the news media has covered that up too. The abusers will often wear masks and costumes. Let's say a programmer wears a Mickey Mouse outfit, and the child would remember and tell, "Mickey Mouse hurt me." Now who is going to believe the child? The child has told the truth, but will be reprimanded for telling the truth. It doesn't take long for a severely abused child, who has been programmed to keep silent, to learn that no one wants to hear the truth anyway. The use of religious fronts. A great deal of monarch programming and slave abuse, as well as the drug trade, is done under three major covers or fronts. Religious fronts, the front of national security and the military, and the entertainment fields, especially the country western industry, the rock music industry and Hollywood. The religious fronts were popular for centuries, especially when groups like the Jesuits, the Assassins, and other groups held immense power. Religious fronts are still being used, such as Jay-Z, Knight, Elizabeth Clare Prophet's Cut Church, the Church of Scientology, the Charismatic Movement, Jim Jones and Jonestown, and David Koresh's group, etc. Billy Ray Moore's Lord's Chapel is entirely a mind control operation. There is a non-denomination Pentecostal church in southern Washington whose entire membership is Satanists under mind control. Various overseas missionary groups are covers for the CIA and mind control. It would take a book to explain how these religious fronts are part of the total trauma-based mind control and how they operate to protect mind control. However, there are publications which go into some of the CIA connections to these groups. It is suggested that interested persons read these publications. Some of the deceptions, such as the lone assassin idea, have been used for centuries as a cover for assassinations planned by the occult hierarchy. If we are going to really reveal how the monarch mind control is done, we will have to explain how the deception is done. If one describes a chameleon only by saying it is like a lizard, without mentioning the camouflage, then the most important part has been overlooked. Religious fronts are an important part of the Illuminati program for making slaves. In fact, due to their Gnostic philosophy of balancing their good deeds with their bad deeds, it is almost essential to have a religious front through which one can do good deeds. Even though adding this section to the book will spur some to blindly lash out at the book, still the whole story needs to come out. When we, the authors of this book, write that the monarch-type total mind control threatens everything this nation stands for, we are not exaggerating. The monarch mind control program has not been used just to program slaves, but it has been part of a much bigger deception. When this deception is realized by this nation, it will shatter the very fabric of trust that Americans have in their institutions. If Americans will begin to understand the power structure behind their institutions, and who controls this structure, they will begin to see the lies in the scripts that they have been fed since infancy. And you, the reader of this next section in this book, if you love the truth, can help begin the healing process to overcome some of the devastation that is going to rock this nation when the truth comes out. This next section will help both Christian and non-Christian reader. The therapist can learn about what is happening so that they can better deal with what the SRA survivors are beginning to reveal. The grooming of the American people to believe massive amounts of lies did work, until a few loving therapists, ministers, and doctors began to liberate victims of the monarch trauma-based mind control. These programmed multiples began revealing a horror story of deception unparalleled in history. For the reader to deal with the next section means courage. It means that the reader will have to muster up some of the same type of love of truth that the mind control survivors must muster to free themselves of the lies of their satanic programming. What we see and hear can be programming, in the same way SRA victims are deceived. Everyone in the Illuminati of any significance has participated in grooming the public to believe that Billy Graham is a great man of God. Graham has stood beside each of the presidents and the Pope. The Illuminati don't just program individuals, they program whole nations. The public has been led to believe in a television image. But what if the secular media's image of Billy Graham is not real? For Christians, it means that they can quit trusting in a man, and place their trust fully on God. For secular readers, they can begin to see the extent of how America's institutions have been corrupted by the horrible trauma-based mind control. The heartbeat of the body of Christ is crying out that something is terribly wrong. We will address that. All of us, whether Christian or not, must step out of the lies and look clearly out into the darkness and see every facet of this evil mind control. When men who worship the God of this world place in God we trust on the Federal Reserve bank notes, we who know the truth must step out of our dream world and realize that they mean Lucifer. By the way, the Federal Reserve is not a government agency, but a private banking institution of the Illuminati. This has been documented in a number of writings. The issue at hand in this next section is to show how the institution called the Christian Church, and the world in general, has been deceived by a programmed multiple and this trauma-based mind control. Secular readers will be shown that the doctrines that Christians want to believe in, have been subtly destroyed under the disguise of building them up. This is no different than the destruction of the positive values which hold any group together. After the repeated collaboration by essentially all the Christian churches worldwide in many activities as the NCC, the Billy Graham Crusades, the Promise Keepers and other programs, the Christian churches, Orthodox, Catholic, Protestant and non-denominational can be considered one institution. The infiltration and control of the Christian religion has been one of the easiest tasks of the Illuminati. The Christian churches are what the intelligence agencies called soft targets. The deception of Billy Graham, a mind control front. In 1992, Billy Graham broadcast all over the U.S. his radio show called Embrace America 2000. In the Louisiana area, it came over the KJAM Lafayette station. During the show, Billy Graham told the American people we need to embrace the New World Order. Billy Graham is also on record stating that people can have salvation through paganism, another name for witchcraft. For instance, in McCall magazine, January 1987, Graham stated, "I used to believe that pagans in far-off countries were lost were going to hell. I no longer believe that. I believe that there are other ways of recognizing the existence of God through nature, for instance. Pagans believe that salvation can be obtained through nature. This is not a pleasant story." Billy Graham has been built up to be the most respected popular person in America, who wants to find out they have been deceived. We will try to give you the facts or evidence, and may God grant you wisdom as you read this. This section is not propaganda for our own personal views. Years ago, when Fritz set out on his search, he had no final outcome in mind. Fritz isn't concerned with concealing facts one way or the other. There is no desire to stampede our readers anywhere. We do want to clarify many issues. We do want to help the truth seeker. But the co-authors personally have no battle to win, except that truth be brought forth. The issues at stake are not trivial. Historically, Billy Graham's deception is one of the greatest deceptions that has ever been perpetrated. Some might argue the greatest, making Benedict Arnold, Quisling, and the Trojan horse pale into insignificance. Allow us to introduce you just briefly into the world of the Illuminati. All top hierarchy Satanists are required to have covers, the Illuminatus will have multiple personalities, and he or she will have one personality that is particularly shown to the outside world. They, the programmers, handlers, and the Illuminati councils, try to get the best covers that they can. They like to be clergymen, but they are also mayors of big cities, lawyers, doctors, etc. A Christian psychiatrist who has worked with numerous victims of Satanism and multiple personality disorder wrote this observation after having worked with a large number of ex-multi-generational programmed satanic multiples. Some Satanists have invaded the church as it is the perfect cover for them. They masquerade as angels of light and gravitate towards positions of leadership in order to have more influence. Because much of what they say is sound doctrinally, they are rarely detected. Most survivors whom I have worked with had Satanist parents who were in high positions in churches, many were pastors. Dr. Fox, Lorda. The spiritual and clinical dimensions of multiple personality disorder. Salita Co., Books of Sangre de Cristo, page 196. Let us repeat what Dr. Lorda Fox said. Most survivors whom I have worked with had Satanist parents who were in high positions in churches, many were pastors. She didn't say some, she said most. Independently, we have discovered the very same thing. People don't grasp that just because a preacher can sincerely preach what seems a perfect sermon, doesn't mean that he can't also be part of the satanic hierarchy. What is happening with the Illuminati's ability to create programmed multiples is that we are getting perfect preachers who are secret hierarchy members. Some of their perfect sermons are full of slides, such as the Christian people need to get involved in the voting process. Christians love to hear such things, it tickles their ears, but the truth is that the entire voting process has been captured and corrupted. Voting machines have repeatedly been exposed to have been rigged, and the controlled media and public denial have prevented Americans from giving up their myth that the common man's votes run this nation. The subject of election corruption is dealt with in Fritz's newsletters, etc. In Fritz's Be Wise as Serpents book, which exposed Billy Graham as a Luciferian in 1991, it is explained that high-level Satanism is Gnosticism, which requires that the force of these great satanic magicians be balanced. In other words, in high-level Satanism, your good deeds must balance your evil deeds. People do not realize that unless someone does good deeds, they cannot be a high-level Satanist. That is why some of the greatest philanthropists are also our leading national Satanists. To see Billy Graham do something commendable does not disqualify him from Satanism. In fact, it is a requirement if he's been part of the Illuminati, such as ex-insiders and witnesses say he was. In fact, it wasn't until working on this book that an eyewitness to the mind control abuse of at the hands of Billy Graham offered to help contribute to this section of the book. In other words, an eyewitness helped write this. This eyewitness account by the co-author matches what the list of eyewitnesses that Fritz assembled in 1993 have said, but the eyewitness went further and exposed BG Crusade's skillful use of monarch slaves to launder drug money. Several police officers have stated that today, there is for all practical purposes no police training helping police to understand Satanism. They are highly trained in many areas, but Satanism is avoided. When an SRA case involving multiplicity in Olympia, Washington recently happened, the police who investigated the case found that they were treated as international experts in Satanism by other policemen. They themselves knew that they knew very little. Where are the experts to teach us about how the Illuminati functions? Where are the experts who know who are in the Illuminati? There is no college open to the public that teaches advanced Illuminati studies 401, and gives degrees in Satanism. The expert witnesses are those who have managed to leave the Illuminati and Satanism, and stay alive long enough to talk. But the other side will argue, how can we verify the testimony of your witnesses, Fritz? Remember what happened to over 100 people who had some type of knowledge about the Kennedy assassination? Jim Mars, in his book Crossfire on the Kennedy assassination, lists 103 people who were key figures in knowing about the assassination who have died, many in circumstances that indicate assassination. The story we are dealing with here is just as sensitive to the elite as Kennedy's assassination, because it involves their preparations for the creation of a false Christ, called by Christians the Antichrist, who will be the master handler and programmer. The list of known and credible witnesses, if the authors were to call my list of witnesses up to the witness stand, which I can't for it would be a death sentence to many of them, the list would include: A. Council of Foreign Relations member, who is secretly against the New World Order. 1. National Security Agency person, who is against the New World Order. B. CIA high-level administrator. C. Satanists, still in covens, but unhappy enough with the situation to talk. 4. Ex-Satanists, 3 of whom are eyewitnesses, all Christians, now 2 ex-New Age leaders who worked with the conspiracy, both became Christians, 1 an ex-33 degree Mason, now a Christian. Various Christians who have worked with Billy Graham, pastors, etc. Various therapists working with SRA victims. The man who ran security at the Sacramento Crusade, Alice Bramer, a woman who worked as a secretary for Gene Dixon. None, except for a couple of exceptions, none of these people knew anything about what the other witnesses, sources, had said. The high degree of validation and collaboration that separate testimony by witnesses who have never seen each other and live in different parts of the country is very powerful. There are several questions that pop up into people's minds who are not familiar with who Fritz is, and are not familiar with these witnesses. The type of worries some readers could be naturally having might be, but how are we, the readers, to know how accurate these people are? Are they trustworthy? Do they have a reputation for honesty? Could they possibly be giving false information to discredit a great man of God? These kind of questions can be natural questions for people unfamiliar with how this information was obtained. But we assure you, that what we pass on from these eyewitnesses can be relied upon. None of these worries have any substance to them, because the manner in which Fritz came to find out about Billy Graham has generally been while he was researching other things related to the Illuminati. The author has not been out to build a case, the case has built itself from numerous detached witnesses who have nothing to gain by telling what they know. These witnesses have not come to Fritz to feed him bogus information. Just the paper trail on Billy Graham is very revealing in itself. Generally, the information of these witnesses has been confided by these witnesses to their trusted friends. Initially, these witnesses have had no idea that the information they confided in their trusted close associates would go beyond their most trusted friends. These trusted friends then have had permission to let me contact them or find out their information. The reason why these people are believable is that the information they reveal could get them killed, and second, the manner and circumstances of how the information has originally unfolded has never been in any fashion or method that could be construed as an attempt to give false information. Clarifying what is looked for in proof? Too many people are considered guilty unless proven innocent, which means that a legitimate search for truth has not taken place. On the flip side, we must bear in mind that hidden information that has laid dormant for years may totally reverse our understanding of something. Exceptional circumstances may surprise us, if some item does not lend itself to totally irrefutable, totally unqualified claims, then knowing this, the proper investigator uses words like almost certainly and most likely. If the investigator feels strongly that everything is totally clear, he may declare that something is correct without qualification. This is the nature of proof. We need to understand the qualifications and reservations that often are attached to evidence or conclusions. But we certainly do want to press our investigations as far as possible to get as many unqualified conclusions as possible. Of course, by the time we write this, we have already done our investigating, and have one conclusion without any qualification: Billy Graham is working for the satanic hierarchy. We want to try to introduce the material in such a way that you will get some sense of the search, so that you will not simply accept our conclusion but will make rational, spirit-led, critically thought-out decisions about Billy Graham. So for the sake of the reader's investigation, please, let us unshackle ourselves from our prejudices and preconceived labels. Let us suspend our judgment about Billy Graham one way or the other, until we have thoroughly studied, prayed, and gained discernment about this. It might be interesting to get some of the Masons, who casually, without realizing what they were saying, have talked about Billy Graham's membership, or other aspects of his Masonic involvement. It's doubtful that such men would be of any value on the witness stand. Their numerous Masonic oaths to lie and conceal Freemasonry under penalties of gruesome death would tend to have more influence on them than swearing on a Bible. See Duncan's Masonic Ritual Book, page 30, for the first degree oath. This type of witness, because they talked accidentally and casually, are very valuable witnesses to whoever accidentally hears them, but unfortunately they must be assumed to be still loyal to the Masonic Lodge and would be hostile witnesses that will not cooperate. If this were an actual court of law, depositions of Billy Graham's staff could be taken, so that it could be revealed to the court how many times they have lied. By showing their lies, their testimony would be impeached and Christians would realize that Billy Graham's staff have played a major role in the deception. This article will put forth evidence that impeaches the testimony of Billy Graham's staff. We must refer readers to the Be Wise as Serpents book and other writings of Fritz for more information. Also, some other books will be named too. Because these leaders are corrupt, they have been participating in the mass deception of the world about what Billy Graham does and who he is. In fact, if this were a court of law, all types of people could be subpoenaed to take depositions, and we might find out many more things than we already know. The motivation of the co-authors. Many people, who like Billy Graham, have imputed evil motives to anyone exposing Billy Graham. As the scripture say at one point, "Am I to become your enemy because I tell you the truth?" The story about Billy Graham and his lifelong career for the Illuminati is not an easy thing for us to write. We do not enjoy speaking negative things against people. We do enjoy speaking positive things about people. And yet no man, no servant of God is above reproach. We can personally have an inner peace that what we have done was what we should have done. Something needs to be done to wake mankind up before it's too late. Clarifying what is acceptable testimony. In some subjects, going to the encyclopedia or almanac will settle questions. In dealing with the Illuminati and high levels of the occult world, unless the investigator is willing to listen to eyewitness testimony, he or she will get nowhere. There is rarely any written record of their secret activities. But how much stock can be put in eyewitnesses? Many people up to now have criticized Fritz for using eyewitnesses. But remember that if we did manage to get some paper trail or books on the subject, that book paper trail would not be acceptable in court, or even if allowed would not be as important as our eyewitnesses. In court, the written records can be introduced along with the person who recorded them. In other words, the personal witness is still important even with written documents. The testimony of our eyewitnesses expose Billy Graham's mind control activities. Still, we want to bear in mind that witnesses have varying degrees of credibility and knowledge. The qualifications of witness in relation to what they are testifying is important. But to simply dismiss all these witnesses because they are not paper is simply to cut ourselves off from many valuable sources of information. In accumulating evidence, the researcher will come upon two types of information. One is prearranged evidence and the other is called casual evidence. Casual evidence is evidence that has just happened to appear by accident. An actual example is when friends of mine met a total stranger who happens to be a Mason and he offhandedly talks about Billy Graham being a Freemason. Casual evidence is simply evidence that happens without the interested party having anything to do with it surfacing. Finding casual evidence is generally luck. In this case, Fritz has bumped into a great deal of casual evidence, simply because he had his eyes open and has been investigating this area for several years. Because of the situation today in this nation, there is little chance to get a proper hearing of this information. In terms of the future, indeed, the backlash from this book may silence us. The truth will still remain, even if we and the other witnesses don't. We can draw conclusions about ducks from studying various types of ducks. I cannot draw conclusions about radios from studying ducks. I can generalize about American-made cars, but I can't include in my generalization about American cars an ox cart in India. This may sound basic, and it is, yet people try to generalize by lumping the generational Satanists in with everybody else, and it just doesn't work. They also try to draw conclusions about the Freemasons on the basis of what the Rotary Club they belong to is like, and it just doesn't work. In terms of trying to get a proper hearing today, one of the barriers is that people use their own experiences to draw conclusions. People have nothing in their experience to allow them to draw conclusions about the Illuminati programmers and handlers who are moral degenerates and programmed multiples, who will do anything, in spite of their nice fronts. The policies of deception by the Billy Graham Crusade staff. In 1992, a Christian named Richard Bennett, a friend of Fritz's, confronted the Billy Graham Crusade staff. What he was concerned about was the Billy Graham Crusade policy, that has been in place since the 50s, of sending Catholics that come forward back to Catholic churches. Documentation shows that the deception is worse than that. New believers that have never gone to any church are sometimes referred by the Billy Graham counselors to the Catholic Church. Now, why would Richard and Fritz be concerned about the Catholic Church? Richard Bennett was a priest from Ireland who worked at the Vatican, before giving his life to Christ. He knows how the Catholic hierarchy prevents people from realizing what they have in Christ. For those who have read Fritz's Be Wise as Serpents book chapter 2.2, you know that Fritz is very concerned when anyone gives their allegiance to a power structure that is part of the NWO and part of its monarch trauma-based total mind control. Not everything about the Catholic Church is wrong. Yet, the Billy Graham Crusade could never get the support it gets from conservative Christians if Billy Graham's staff didn't lie about where Crusade converts are sent. What Richard and Fritz were concerned about was that new Christians would be sent to Catholic churches, which now are teaching Zen Buddhism, New Age things, not the salvation by grace that these new Christians need. Granted, the enthusiasm of these new Christians might infuse some life into the Catholic Church, but a babe in Christ is defenseless. He needs nurture, and the chance to grow. It isn't meant for new Christians to be thrown to the wolves. Anyway, last spring and summer, the Billy Graham Crusade Executive Committee was confronted face to face with the evidence of what the Billy Graham Crusade in Sept. 93 was going to do. Actually, more people than Richard did confront them, but Richard is one of the most knowledgeable ministries to the Catholics in this area. What the Billy Graham Crusade Executive Committee told Richard Bennett was that he had nothing to worry about. That the crusade would never send anyone to a Catholic church, but that if new converts wanted to go there on their own, that was their own choice. Four Catholic leaders sat on the executive committee for the 92 Portland Crusade: Chancellor Mary Jo Telly, a deacon, and two priests. On the Catholic radio station, and we have it recorded, Mary Jo Telly of the Billy Graham Executive Committee along with another Bishop Wal Schmidt told the Catholic listeners not to worry that if they came forward they would be guaranteed that they would be referred back to a Catholic church. They gave the assurance four times in that talk show. They said that the decision to send people who came forward to Catholic churches was firm because it had come right from the very top. This was 6 p.m. KVDM Portland Station. Our recording of this is a record of just one of thousands of lies that the Billy Graham Crusade people have told Christians over the years. In fact, from the evidence it appears the Billy Graham Crusade people say whatever they have to, regardless of the truth. In the North Star Baptist, November 1964, there was an article by Japheth Perez, who as a convert in the New York 1957 Billy Graham Crusade and a brand new Christian, was sent to a Catholic church by the Billy Graham Crusade. Ian Paisley wrote this comment about Billy Graham's staff: Dr. Graham did not reply. He never does reply to letters like this. He states he never defends himself. He does have a staff, however, who are paid to defend him and who are never hampered by facts or bothered by ethics or logic in carrying out their duties. One of the group, George L. Edstrom, replied, "The Jesuits themselves could not give a finer example of casuistry than his. It is thoroughly dishonest and deceitful. However, since this technique of deceit by misdirection, this failure to face up to the issues, this disregard of fact, and this blasphemous attempt to identify Dr. Graham's official connection with infidels and his flattery and endorsement of them with our Lord's ministry to publicans and sinners is so typical of the Graham organization." In Fritz's June 93 newsletter from a Christian ministry, a letter from Graham's staff was reproduced with a point-by-point exposure of its lies. Christians are really not well aware of what the Billy Graham Crusade does. We quote a paragraph from a letter sent to Billy Graham clear back in the 1950s by a pastor who, grieved by what Billy Graham was doing to the harvest field, said, "Some people say that if you have just one convert in an evangelistic campaign, it is worth the meeting. That is not true. The evangelist, as the pastor and teacher, is given to the body of Christ. The real test of an evangelistic campaign is not how many people are converted, but what kind of a spiritual condition does it leave in a community. Billy Graham is not only failing in the number of people he leads to the Lord Jesus Christ in this day when hearts are hungry and most people are afraid of what may happen in the world and when it is easier to get people converted than it ever has been in my lifetime, but Billy Graham is pulling the limbs off of the evangelistic trees and the orchard is being left in bad condition. As we have often said, the real test of an evangelist is not just how many converts he has, but does he leave the orchard in condition so it will keep bearing fruit.